Miss Croft, pardon the mess in the foyer, but a rather large shipment of antiquities arrived while you were out. I would have had the crates placed in the gallery, but the security alarm has somehow been activated, locking the room from the inside. If this was not concerning enough, the renovators have shut off the water supply to the entire manor in order to continue construction of the pool house. On the bright side, I've located your missing journal and returned it to its appointed hiding place in your room. Faithfully in your service, Winston.
Brothers and sisters, comrades and friends, my name's CubaLibre. Welcome to the Croft Manor.
And there he stood, assuring all within earshot of his coming victory until it was time to return to his ships, leaving Athens to undertake his mighty task.
And there's all these books that you can read in here. They're kind of dumb and useless. But I'll try to shut up when she's reading so
and
you can hear.
And even as their hooves shook the earth beneath him, Gilead gathered his remaining strength and drew back his bow. The Trials of Gilead, Volume 1.
Now these ones that are marked as the Trials of Gilead are like important to the sort of main puzzle
very interesting.
Of the manor. I hear you, Lar. It's not very interesting. Anyways, they are relevant, but unlike in the Legend Manor, you don't actually need them at all. They're just sort of like, there's a bow and an arrow. True. And that's all there is to say. There's plenty of visual information. You don't need them at all to figure out the puzzle. Anyway, so, the first thing I want to talk about is this game in particular. If you watch the Let's Play, you know that I mostly complimented the game. It sure as shit is way better than Legend, and when you add in this sort of more fluid and dynamic and reactive Legend controls with the old Tomb Raider level design, it's a little bit of a best of both worlds situation. It's a rocky road of a video game. But,
I wonder where this goes.
Probably in a sculpture, that's why it's called Sculpture Gear. Anyways, it does have its flaws. And mostly they are in storytelling. Anything with human beings in this game doesn't make a damn lick of sense. And the story overall is pretty interesting to me because in the original game,
it's rather hot.
Yeah. Can't use the gear on the fire. Anyways, in the original game, Lara was kind of a psycho. She was super powered. You know, giant breasted. She had no apparent morals. She just raids teams because it's fun, and she's rich, and she's bored, and she's like super competent, but has no sense of an ethical duty. Really, she's not giving these relics to a museum or so they can be studied.
But the new pharaoh was not content with all that was now his. No. Ramses II wanted even more. He had visions of an empire so spectacular, all mankind would come to marvel at its glory.
And, she just seems to do it for fun. You know, she kills dinosaurs and, you know, she doesn't take any remains back to, people who might care about the fact
by
there's living
the
dinosaurs.
By far the most intriguing is the legend surrounding the fabled dagger of Zion and the awesome power it wields.
Yes, it's very interesting. These books really have nothing to do with anything. Some of them reference the game. Some of them reference stuff in the game, like there's one about guns, because Lara uses guns. I don't know. It's very weird.
I've never been fond of locked doors.
So yeah, it locks you in here, which is great.
It was here in the 6th century BC, between the Aventine and the Palatine Hills, that the Circus Maximus was born.
So I came up here first because I know the general layout of the place from the manor in Legend. And I know up here there were smaller places. I thought I could clean them out more quickly. Probably get some of the necessary equipment before moving on to the big rooms.
Thousands of travelers into the region annually. Delhi was soon overrun by merchants selling goods of every possible description.
And again, I do think that this level is probably the best level in Tomb Raider Anniversary, but it's not as much of a distinction. I don't like the manor in this as much as the manor in Legend, and I like the other levels in this way more than the other levels in Legend.
I've read all of these.
So it's not as much of a difference. Clearly I need guns to shoot out that window. And there's also a ring on the bottom of the chandelier over there for a grappling hook. But there are levels in this that I really like, unlike in Legend, where there was no levels that I really liked.
When the Spaniards had all but wiped out the Incan Empire, the remaining survivors fled to the mountains and disappeared. Legends say they retreated to the hidden city of Vilcabamba.
It is one thing about the level design in this game, though. It basically gets steadily weaker as the game goes on, after an early peak. And sort of the first two areas, there's Peru and Greece, are the best. And probably the most interesting environment in the whole game is that shaft in St. Francis Folly.
Now all you need is something to shoot.
Well, there's plenty to shoot. Anyways, with the, all the rooms themed after the gods.
Were lost beneath the sea when the glaciers melted some 10,000 years ago. As he struggled mightily to calm himself, Gilead removed the poison arrow from its quiver. The Trials of Gilead, Volume 2. Anyone with even a cursory knowledge of mineralogy would arrive at the same conclusion. Wherever this Isis stone was formed, it wasn't on Earth.
After the Greece levels, the game gets a lot more abstract. Like, the levels become a lot more just suited to Lara's skill set, and they're a lot less naturalistic. They seem less like real places and more just places that were designed to be platforming challenges for the moveset Lara has. Which is, of course, not really my... The game's a fun platformer, but the platforming itself is not that fun. It's more of a means to explore. And exploration is at its most entertaining, at least, when the environment is authentic. Or at least somehow interesting to explore, when it's just a series of ledges and jumps and stuff. It's not so interesting. And it's most seen in the Atlantis levels at the very end, which are just, like, crazy. Natla's mines, the mine section with the gears and all that stuff, or the fuses and the crane, and that's pretty cool. I enjoy those levels a lot. But once you get to the Atlantis island thing, obviously that bucket is to put water in to put out the fire. I knew that immediately. Of course, the water's off, as Jeeves tells you at the beginning. I forget his real name, but he might as well be Jeeves. Yeah, the last few levels are pure, just like, platforming skill. There's no exploration at all, really. And then the bosses are intensely disappointing. They all use this same general idea where there's a rage meter, which you just shoot them with anything and it builds up their rage. And, these are just the relics you can find in the game, the super dinguses.
Exquisite.
And you can just look at them, they don't actually do anything, but I don't know whether or not they do, so I end up looking at each one after
Father
I
would have loved this.
Get lost in here and can't find my way out.
I've never been fond of locked doors.
The whole rage meter thing is an interesting mechanic, I guess. It's better than just like having to shoot them 100 times to death, I guess. But it's just overused. Every boss is the same, and it's just you basically put your back to some environmental hazard and enrage them and do your little matrix shoot dodge deal, and then that's every boss. And the last few are just easier even than the ones before. And it's frustrating and kind of lame.
The luxury liner, Maria Doria, has never been found. However, treasure hunters the world over search endlessly for its resting place. And while any number of things can go wrong underground, the most dangerous aspect of spelunking is exposure to methane gases, which are difficult to detect without specific equipment. The roots of the banyan tree grow relentlessly and in every direction. Many of the ancient temples of Angkor have been brought down as those roots exploit the small spaces between their massive stones. The concept of the sundial has existed for thousands of years and is one of the earliest devices for time measurement. There's some numbers written on the inside cover. 11, 2, 7. I wonder what they refer to.
So obviously those numbers are a solution to a puzzle. And what I'm doing right now is writing them down on a piece of paper. But it turns out you don't need to. There's visual indicators when you get to the place where you actually have to use them. But anyways, and then the last boss was super disappointing. I mean, Nala was pathetically easy. She can barely do any damage to you. And you have like a bajillion health packs at that point. I mean, if I had been playing it on hard, I would only have 10 full health packs instead of 25 full health packs or something.
This belongs down in the garden. What's she doing in here?
Less damage than any of the other bosses, and she's like this immortal queen of death and whatever. It doesn't make any sense. Anyways, those are the failings of the game, but really, overall, it's a far superior game to Legend. There's much less talking. All those stupid friends with their little wisecracks.
Exquisite.
So irritating, and they just don't exist in this game.
This didn't get damaged.
The human bosses being QTE fights.
Exquisite.
Was, as much as I hate QTEs, and I do, it's better than the original Tomb Raider, where it was just like
stunning addition to my collection.
Auto-aim versus auto-aim, and you just hold down the trigger and try and kill them before they kill you.
Lovely.
Pretty boring. At this point, I've exhausted sort of everything in both these rooms for now, and I can't find my way out. It turns out that the solution is pretty simple. But first, I have to muck around and try and find my way out. This is that map that I found. Clearly, that's to something else on the grounds that I haven't been to yet. It's actually interesting because the layout is the same as the Legend Manor, but there's some slight differences. For instance, the secret passage in the Legend Manor goes to Lara's bedroom, whereas here it goes to this room that isn't even open. But these, once that crate falls over, I realize they're destructible, so I blew them all up just in case that does something. It doesn't, but it's a reference to Legend, where there were destructible crates in this secret passage, and they had dinguses inside them. It's kind of interesting. So the game has its ups and downs, but it's far superior. The thing about it is, all the best parts about it are the level design that it just cribbed from the original game, which was made in 1990-whatever. I forget when, 4 or 5, 6. I guess it was on PlayStation, so probably 6, 96. Anyways, it's like the only way they can make a decent exploratory platforming game these days is to copy an old one. Now, speaking of the original game, I wanted to talk a little bit about the history and why I think the original game was what it was and everything else was not as good. The lead designer on the original game is a man named Toby Gard. And while I don't know much about him personally, I don't know if he's written anything or if he has some kind of manifesto somewhere, but he basically came up with the character of Lara Croft and his vision was this vision behind the game in the first place. He left for Tomb Raider 2, which is why Tomb Raider 2 is already different from Tomb Raider 1. It's a lot less naturalistic and a lot more of these clearly designed environments. Obviously there's something behind that bookcase. I can see that there's space back there, but I don't know how to open it. This is my genius idea. I was like, maybe I can shoot these things? I don't know. It doesn't work. And so he left anyway. He left the company for Tomb Raider 2, and the next game he made was a game called Galleon. like years later on the Xbox, so next generation. And while I haven't myself played Galleon, I finally figured it out. There's just this keypad here, it just opens the fucking door. Oh, you just have to press
it. That's best.
It's because it was the same kind of blinking light, I just assumed it was the same thing, but I didn't. I guess it's my fault for not seeing the little keypad underneath it. There's another hallway full of stupid books.
The native population of Costa Rica was ravaged by diseases brought by its conquerors and barely managed to survive to see the establishment of a capital city. By far the most important survival item one can possibly have is the will to survive.
So at any rate, I've never played Galleon. After playing this and it reminding me of Tomb Raider 1 and how good I thought it was, I really want to. This is where I make a winker joke for all you select button people. But Galleon is supposed to be the most fantastic 3D exploratory game in the vein of Tomb Raider. It's the same guy that made Tomb Raider what it was, plus 7 years of experience and a higher.
Better still, the new 50 caliber round comes with a full metal jacket designed to maximize muzzle velocity and power to the target.
Great. A higher budget and a better hardware.
While other traps have a similar closing mechanism, it was the Egyptians who perfected the savage effectiveness of the holding barbs.
So, maybe I can track down a copy of that. I don't know whether there's ever a PC port. If there was, maybe I'll record it. It would be a nice cap, I think, to the Tomb Raider thing. Of course, they sell it to play Underworld, which is the one that came after this. And from what I understand, it's a lot more sort of action-y and platformy and a lot less exploratory and naturalistic. People tend to think this is the best recent Tomb Raider game.
I'll slip into something else.
And these are the reward outfits you get. I tried to find something reasonable, but in a break from tradition, they're either just weird, or they're all actually more revealing than her normal clothes, which is bizarre. This cat suit doesn't look so bad, so I try it out, but when you're actually wearing it, it's all shiny and, like, ridiculous looking. So I keep it on for a while, but eventually I can't deal with it anymore and I change out of it.
I think I'll slip into something else.
Look at this. It's just side boob. It's just retarded. I don't know who would wear
this
ever. I think
I'll slip into something else.
Anyways. Apparently Toby Gard had something to do with making Lara this way. He didn't originally intend for the whole marketing of the game to be around how she was a sex putt, but I think he was somewhat complicit in it.
Gilead knew the gears of his heart would never turn again, as he sacrificed his one true love to save the kingdom he had fought for so long to protect. The Trials of Gilead, Volume 3.
And speaking of new Tomb Raider games, obviously the one that's coming out with the whole rapey controversy, I think it's awful. I desperately want that game to be good, because I consider myself a Tomb Raider fan, even though I only really like...
I wonder if Winston read any of it.
1.5 of these games. Yeah, there's a whole thing to find the journal.
Medusa is a frightful creature in Greek mythology.
And it's completely worthless, just like it is in the main game, so...
Medusa was a fright...
Thanks a lot for the journal. I really appreciate that. It's great.
It is only through knowing our history that we can learn from the past. Prolific evidence exists that the ancient Eskimos would carve extremely detailed ivory maps of their coastline and hunting waters.
At any rate, it's pretty interesting that...
Pink is the new black.
Great. Fashion advice. At any rate, it's pretty interesting that the original character was, like I said, this sort of like happy-go-lucky psycho, basically, who doesn't care about academia or history or anything, really, just getting her kicks, and that now they're so obsessed with, like, making her real and showing how she was weak and how she developed. At this point I decide, you know what, this cat suit's retarded. I can't do it, so I have to go back and change it again. I end up settling on the wetsuit, which is weirdly like the least ridiculous outfit.
I think I'll slip into something else.
I don't know how that happened, but so yeah, it's showing her, you know, how she's a weak girl and how she's like learns to kill to survive. And that's actually also the plot of this game, like, for what it's worth, the character development of Lara, which just starts, like, three quarters of the way through the game, because they don't give a shit leading up to that, is how she learns to murder, and, like, for the good of whatever, the world. And it's kind of weird that the new game is actually sort of the same plot, or the same character arc. It's like, I think it's just indicative of modern game design. Older game heroes could just be these archetypical heroes. They didn't have to be humanized. They were
legend
conduits.
Tells that the kings of Tibet were descendants from heaven with ropes attaching them to heaven itself. When they died, a heavenly creature would pull the ropes up, bringing their bodies up with them.
Conduits for player empowerment.
As Charles Kane notes in his superb history of the Iron Curtain, there were numerous historical precedents against the practicality or feasibility of the fortress system of foreign policy.
Now, of course, everything's trying to be cinematic and filmic, so they need to humanize their characters. Even though, of course, even some of the best movies have archetyped characters.
No.
I can tell looking at this thing. I just tried everything I had just in case, but it looks like a little music box. It's got those little tines. I don't know if you can see that on the video, but or like one of those African thumb piano things. So obviously I have to come back to that. Turns out that's like sort of the last place in the mansion. That's where you end the level. That's after you've completed everything else. Which seems about right, having a weird lock like that. So yeah, and as weirdly hilarious as that original Lara was, I think it's much more appropriate to the game, and is much more fun to play. I didn't have to feel the melodramatic weight of her murder decisions. I don't know. I could see how there could be a good game like that, but this isn't that game. So obviously there's that big gold bow on that statue. Clearly I'm going to need to get a hold of it at some point. But the question is how to get through this room. Once again, multiple paths. It's pretty good. Now, what's weird is that I've been calling these types of games exploratory 3D platformers. But the question arises, was this ever really a genre at all? Or was it really just Toby Gard making these couple games? A normal 3D platformer is just about, typically, is just about the actual platforming, the action. It's like 2D Mario. It's about the kinesthetic friction of it, not the actual exploration so much of the levels. Obviously, there's elements of both in all of these games. There has to be. But you can tell where the emphasis lies. One is on one is on exploration, and the other is on the actual kinetic motion. But I do think that some of the original 3D platformers, before there was a very established series of genre rules, really were almost as much about exploration as they were about execution. I mean, like the original Mario 64, the original Jak and Daxter. There was a whole world in those games where you thought there could be anything, really, just over the horizon. And that mostly disappeared in most of those game sequels. Jak and Daxter 2 was nominally more open world, but it was kind of this GTA thing. And the hub, the GTA hub, was really just a fun, if you feel like it's fun, mechanism of getting from one little self-contained challenge area to the next. Now this place is obviously a reference to the legend Croft Manor, where you move those spears, you rotate those spears around on those statues.
I wish I had to do that.
And it opens that panel in the back wall of the alcove. Stupidly, I don't realize that when I run over that little panel on either side where the statue used to be, that it goes down, and I sort of miss the significance of this part. But what I do know is that to get to the next platforming section across the way, I need a grapple hook. There's a grapple ring on the left-hand wall here. And while I can get around the platforms right in front of me, I can get across them. Once I get over there, I'll need the ring to do the wall run to get across to the other side. So I can't do much more in here until I have the grapple. That becomes sort of a theme in a minute. But yes, I really think the genius of Mario 64 was twofold. One was in the beautiful way they allowed you to move around a 3D environment, which hadn't really been charted yet. Tomb Raider's attempt was kind of a cinematic platformer attempt where everything was in delineated tiles and squares. Mario 64's was much more fluid, and it's kind of like replicating the 2D Mario in 3D space. But you really felt like almost anything could be in those levels. They were just abstract enough that they felt like real, if totally fantastic, places. I'm just looking where those ropes go. Obviously, you have to shoot all the ropes to make the statue fall. Wondering how to get up there. I can see you can crawl along those ledges, and also now I see that the ring I was talking about. So I realize I really need the grapple to get over there. I also can't make that jump all by itself in between those things. But I see that this thing is grabbable, so I'm like, oh, okay, clearly that's a post, so you can jump into the middle. I just set it up for next time, because I have to come back when I get the grapple. But even those 3D games turned themselves into hubs with challenge areas attached, rather than contiguous spaces that seem inhabitable. So, you know, Super Mario Galaxy, you literally have each little planetoid is just like a level. And even Mario Sunshine, which was still quite exploratory, shot itself in the foot by making it so you could only get whatever star you select at the beginning. You know, as opposed to Mario 64, when it'll give you a hint for the next harder star that you can get in the level, but you can get any of them at any time if you just stumble upon them. In Sunshine, you have to pick which one you get ahead of time, and then you're just in that level, like, focused on doing that one thing. And as the games went on, they just became less and less exploratory and more challenge-based. Now, there's nothing wrong with a challenge-based platformer, of course. They can be awesome, really. But I just prefer these kinds, personally. I like the mystery. This is what I was talking about in my Legend video. I like the mystery more than the execution factor. When you come right down to it, platform games just really aren't that hard compared to, I mean, they can be, I suppose. You have the whole massacre idea, but it's not like a fighting game. It's really hard to include that much technique in a platforming game. Ultimately, you only ever have a couple actions. So making a game that's about controlling those actions to pinpoint accuracy can be fun. But ultimately, what's more interesting to me is using those things as a means to get around an environment. I mean, there's an argument that can be made that the games that picked up the torch dropped by this sort of stunted branch of game design are like 3D open world games. Not so much a GTA. But like an Assassin's Creed or something, or Just Cause 2, or Crackdown. These are games that are about platforming in fun ways, which, you know, how fun they are might depend on the game and your opinion of the platforming. But regardless, through these big environments, which are supposedly naturalistic, they're cities or islands or whatever, places where people are supposed to live. And, you know, using your skills to get around, explore these huge, humongous areas. But there's a thing those games are missing, and that's sort of the mind of the designer. Really, the key with these exploratory 3D platformers is that they are on the one hand naturalistic, but on the other hand clearly designed. There are nooks and crannies that have been hand-placed by an intelligent designer. see, there's another grapple thing. Can't get over there. Can't use it. I see that bar up there and think maybe I can get somewhere from there, but of course you can't yet until you... So on the other side, there's another grapple ring right there, you can see. So I've done everything I can do in this room until I get a grapple again. So I really need a grapple at this point. Yeah, it looks like you might be able to jump all the way to that hanging blue thingy, but you just can't get enough distance. So the open world games don't do it for me because they're too random. Like I said in my Legend video, I want dead ends, I want to be red herrings, I want to be fooled, I want there to be multiple paths through an environment, but there's a place at which that also breaks down. Just like any concept taken to its extreme always breaks down. In that case, there's just too many dead ends. Almost every end is a dead end. There's almost nothing to find. It's just building after building. Nothing's unique. There's no interesting formations. except places they build sort of within these sprawling cities to... I thought maybe I could jump to that green ladder over there, but clearly I can't. Then I'm like, maybe I can grab that. Nope, can't. Luckily those mats are there. I think they actually do reduce fall damage if you land on them. But, yeah, if you get... There's a couple of these little weird cuts in the video. That's where I get a text or a Steam message and have to pause the video and start re-recording afterwards. So, a good exploratory 3D platformer is some happy medium between these two things. It's not a totally directed challenge experience, but on the other hand, it's not... See, now this really threw me for a loop. In Legend, that door is not openable, so this is just like a whole other area of the manor that's new for this game. It turns out to be that garden for which I have the map. And this is where... This is sort of the locus, actually, of the whole thing. You have to come here to get the grapple, come here to turn on the water, and you come here to solve the bow and arrow puzzle in the end. I don't know that yet, of course. I'm still poking around. Keeping my eye out. There's 8 dinguses in this level, so I'm keeping my eye out for them all. So yes, the ideal exploratory platformer is this happy medium between an open world game with a million dead ends and a challenge game with no dead ends. There's some kind of human-sized handful of possibilities that is interesting. So it's not too predictable, but it's not too unpredictable at the same time. So clearly this is the water pipe, so it's a big water thing on the side, but you need some kind of item to turn it on. I don't know what yet, but what I need to find. And this, of course, is the sundial puzzle. It involves the numbers I took down. But first of all, you read this. It says 11 to 7. 11 to 7, which is, I guess, sort of clever. And even and beyond that, the 11, 2, and 7 are obviously raised and brighter. They're easier to see. So even if you never found that book, you wouldn't really need it if you just use a little bit of lateral thinking. I guess you'd have to know which order to go in. But you just go clockwise and you get it. So even totally guessing, you could probably get it. And this is like the problem with digital movement, the WASD keys. When you get around to the edges of the movement, you have to hit the other key fast enough that it picks up going the other way instead of turning you around. It's weird, but because you don't have an analog stick. Now the maze is interesting. Of course, so there's my grapple. I need to get in there. And obviously the entrance is across the way there, directly across is the entrance to that central square. And here's where the map comes in handy. Now fortunately, they give you this map to navigate around, but instead of just going right to the middle, I'm like, I bet they hid some dinguses around, and of course they did. So I have to check every single like interesting landmark on the map to make sure there's not a special dingus there. I think there's actually three in the whole thing, which you'll see. So there's a lot of me stopping and staring at the map and figuring out how to get to the next landmark. Luckily, at least all the landmarks are on the map. And they weren't so ornery as to put dinguses just in like random corners. They're at least in interesting places. Now that is a thing I wanted to point out about the game, the main game. I really like in the main game that the bonus items are all findable on your own. They're all in interesting little nooks and crannies that you can find by yourself with just a modicum of persistence and observation and, in some cases, platforming skill. Unlike the dinguses in Legend, which some of them were like that, some of them were in bizarre places that I never even found. I found every single bonus item in this game on my own, and without banging my head against the wall and searching every level like 8 times over. And that's a good feeling. To an extent, that contradicts the things that I've been saying about how mysterious and complex I want these games to be, but at the end of the day, again, it's a happy medium. I don't want to be completely unable to find some things without an FAQ. But at the same time, I don't want to just stumble across every bonus item right in my face. So the one great example of a bad way to do it is in an open world game like GTA, where you have the hidden packages or the pigeons in GTA 4. It's a massive open world, and there's like 100 bonus things to find, and they could just literally be in any cranny. I don't know how they expect any human being to actually explore those worlds thoroughly enough to find every single one of those things. Like, you'd have to be completely anal. There's no way you could guarantee you didn't just like overlook a little corner, you know, just because of the way you moved your camera as you ran by it or something. It's the world is just too open. It's one reason I love Red Dead Redemption, by the way. I think it solves all the problems GTA 4 presented. And one of them was the whole, oh god, a grapple. Suddenly I've opened up way more paths.
This should help getting into those hard to reach places.
So that looks like a ring you can pull on, so I pull it off. Lo and behold, I bet I can find where that statue gear goes. But it doesn't seem to do anything yet.
This should make for a shorter return trip.
And when I go up here, you can see that there's little icons of a bow and an arrow. So, again, those tomes are about the bows and the arrows. But I can tell just by looking at it that I need that arrow from the fireplace and that bow from the pool room. And they both go right there. Now that thing, I don't have any idea what it is. But obviously I need it, because it's glowing. I need all glowing things. And instead of going out the easy way that I just opened for myself, obviously I have to go through the whole rest of the maze, because there may or may not be dinguses in there, so. Anyways. Yeah, Red Dead Redemption solved the problem by having the hunting missions and the treasure maps. So instead of just having random things lying around the world scattered seemingly randomly throughout a gigantic place, they split that into two different ideas and focus them, refine them. One is skill-based to an extent, so you have to know where certain animals live and hunt them, and the hunting is part of the skill. You need to shoot them, and you know, to aim at them and shoot them and not die. The other, of course, is the treasure maps, which are, there's only 10, I think. And they show you a very unique configuration of space that you can then keep an eye out for as you travel around, rather than just poking your head into every single random corner of the world. And those are far superior incentives to explore because they are more focused. Again, it's this middle of the road thing where they don't tell you too much or just shove you down a linear Call of Duty-esque corridor. But at the same time, they're not just like, here's a 10 square mile virtual area, find 100 hidden things. It's just enough direction, but not too much. That's the theme. It's parched there. Time to get a drink. Luckily, this is a post-commentary, so I can just stop it and do whatever I want. So this is a post-commentary, as you can tell. I've been asked by a few people, you know, why I... Oh, there's another glitch, because Frap started freaking out. At any rate. My theory on commentaries is that voice works better sometimes, and subtitles work better other times. In a more directed game experience, a more action or execution-based game, often you have little to think about and a lot to do. So to talk constantly over top of such a game would include a lot of just chatter that's not game-related, because it's like, I have to kill these guys, that's pretty much all there is to say. So you end up either with a lot of lame jokes or nerdy rambling. Of course, also those games require a lot more concentration, so it's just harder to talk while you're doing them. So I tend to favor subtitles for those kinds of game experiences. Meanwhile, for a more RPG-ish or a game with a heavier strategy element, you're constantly weighing a lot more options all the time. So you can actually just talk all the time and still be talking about the game, because at any given moment you're weighing 3 or 4 or 5 options, and you can explain why you picked the ones you did, why you didn't pick the ones you didn't, and so forth, and the relative advantages and disadvantages. So I've retrieved my grapple, and now I've opened a whole bunch of new paths for myself. So we'll start by clearing out the gym room here, getting everything there is to get. Additionally, some people have talked about when I edit, what I edit. Now the exploration of the manor here is mostly unedited, save for a couple parts where I really just spent a lot of time doing the same thing over and over again. The main game, I do a fair amount of editing. I tend to keep in everything being explored once. So I poke in every dead end that I can find and stuff, and I tend to save the footage of the first time I do each one of those things. I also tend to save the footage of the first time I attempt a platforming challenge and then die ignominiously. That's just because a lot of times I'll do the same thing, like literally 6 or 7 times in a row and keep dying, and it would just get really boring to any viewer. Ugh. So normally, like, if this were a normal level, I would cut out me getting back up to that jump. But here I'm not, because I'm doing this post-commentary, and I guess I just feel like it's more appropriate in the Croft Manor to show the whole thing, just because it's a more exploratory level overall. And I guess it also just gives me more time to ramble. But generally, multiple failures in the same place or in the same way are boring to watch, so I cut them out. Similarly, seeing this me look into the same dead ends 3 times in a row is probably pretty boring. To an extent, you might get a better feeling of what it's like to actually play the game, but each of these videos would be 3 times as long if I didn't cut what I cut. And there's the stuff that would be in there would contain absolutely no unique content. I try to keep everything that is unique, at least one shot of every place that is unique, and then I cut out any subsequent stuff where I have to plow through 3 or 4 or 5 times just because I miss something, or I fall and have to get back up to a place where I've been, or whatever else. And I mentioned earlier, I actually like the Legend Manor better than the Anniversary Manor. And I think this room is a good example as to why. Now, I don't know if you recall, but if you go back and watch the Legend Manor, there's the gym room is in the same place, and it's a lot like this. There's like these fake rock walls and poles to climb on and whatnot. But this one is actually a lot more direct. There's only not just one real path to get everywhere, which is ultimately mostly the same in the Legend Manor, but there's only one apparent path to get anywhere. Like, you can instantly look at it and see, like, okay, so I have to go up there to get there, and go up there to get there. And in Legend, it wasn't like that at all. The paths were overlapping. A big part of that was the little grapple points where you could pull out sections of the wall and, like, basically reconfigure the paths in ways you might not expect. Or there's not really hardly any of that in here. It's all static. In this game, the most dense, I suppose, area of crisscrossing paths is that hub shaft in the St. Francis Folly underneath the church that connects the 4 god rooms. It's still probably the most interesting platforming part of the game. And it's better than anything in the manor in this game. But ultimately, I still like how the manor is all contiguous, and it includes layered puzzles. Like, you need to turn on the wire to do this, and then you need to get put out the fire to get the arrow. But the arrow is only half of that puzzle solution. There's a whole other half of the section where you need to get the bow, and that requires this and that. I really like that, and that's, again, most basically missing from the main game. The most you get is, like, a hub where it's like, get 4 things, and you can get them all separately. And then you just assemble them in some central location. This is more layered. So, another interesting thing, I should go back to Toby Gard, because I made him out to be this white knight, this hero of... I go back out to the garden because I found a wrench, and I figure plumbing, wrench, yes, that goes together, so I can probably turn the water on. But the weird thing about Toby Gard is, after making Tomb Raider 1 and then Galleon, Winker, he actually was the creative type sort of director of Legend. So he actually was somewhat, at least, directly responsible for all the story and thematic stuff in that game. And then again, in this game, he took even more control. And again, it was a... Or I guess he took less control, but it was still creative. In the sense that he didn't do much about the level design or the mechanics, but it was all more about the story and dialogue and whatever. And it's pretty bad in these games. Which just makes me think that he envisions himself on the cinematic side of games, you know, doing motion capture, dialogue, writing, sort of being a movie director. But really, his talents lie in the level design, and he ought to just forget all the cinematic shit and stick with making actual video games rather than sticking movies into video games. Apparently, he took even more control in Underworld. That was kind of his, his real re-entry back into video games. So we'll see how that is when I finally do Underworld. That won't be for a while, because I've done a lot of Tomb Raider recently. Now, one thing I do want to mention, in terms of Tomb Raider, is Lara Croft and the Guardian of Light, which is that sort of gate-end game that they made as a two-player co-op, isometric. And it's just a pure action platforming game. That game is great. It's a fantastic game. Of course, it's nothing like... hey, Denny. That's my buddy, Denny. Steve messaging me. Flylighter. Since that other door across the way opened, I thought, hey, maybe that door opens now. But it doesn't. So. Denny goes by Flylighter on the... everywhere, really.
Winston will be able to start another fire tonight.
But also on the select button forums.
Yes.
So there's that arrow, one half down. Now at this point, I try to answer Denny's thing, but I end up crashing the game. So I freak out because I thought I might have to do the whole manor over again, but when I reloaded in, I still have everything. It just put me back into her default outfit, unfortunately. Anyways, Flylighter's YouTube channel, ShadowClown169. He's doing a Daggerfall Let's Play, which is awesome. And y'all should go check that out. Just a little shout out to my buddy. At any rate, here we go to the pool room to use my new grapple to do what I need to do. Anyways, back to the Guardian of Light. Game's great. It is a wonderful little arcade challenge. It's nothing like, it has nothing to do with the exploratory 3D platform. I mean, it does to an extent. There are little bonus items and stuff, but it's a lot more combat oriented, and there's time trials, and it's a really good arcadey experience. It's like the Gauntlet version of Tomb Raider, which sounds weird, and it is. It's a weird idea. I don't know who came up with that idea, who saw Tomb Raider and said, this is the kind of game we need to make in the Tomb Raider franchise. But whoever had that idea was a forward thinker. It's a really good game. It's really fun to play co-op, too. Hopefully you should be seeing a lot more co-op later from me. I started recording me playing with my buddy Nick some Modern Warfare 3 Spec Ops, which is good times. Hopefully we'll also be doing Saints Row 3, which is just a ridiculous fucking game. This seems dangerous, but I get out of the thing's way. Now I notice that this is only one gate of two open, and this is one thing I don't figure out for a while as to what that's actually for, because that's not part of the solution for getting the bow. For that, you just need to blow open all the ropes, and the third rope is across the way on that little balcony. This is actually really frustrating, managing this plank. It took me a lot to. The physics aren't really solid enough, and the controls aren't really precise enough to manage this kind of a very precise timing-based puzzle. But I end up getting it. Yeah, when it's all the way down on one side, it becomes steep enough that you do the automatic slide. So you have to sort of manage to get across it while it's high enough to jump onto that plank you see to the right, but not so high that it's too steep of an angle. Yeah, Guardian of Light, awesome. If any of you know me on Steam, I'll be happy to play it with you. Although, I say that, but it's not exactly true. I did conquer the crap out of that game. I got every single bonus item. I beat every single challenge. And so I've kind of, you know, played it out. But it's still a good game. Yeah, it's just like, what? I tried to jump there, and that's what happened. So, here's me actually figuring it out, finally. I just skipped it. You saw a few failed attempts. There was many more. It's getting a little frustrating, but I eventually did it. But I am always curious.
I suppose I'll have to order another statue.
She's the 1%. I always am curious about feedback. You know, whether the... I got some good feedback this time about my videos being too dark, which is good. It's something I've tried to correct in rendering. About whether you like subtitles versus dubs and all that stuff. I'm always curious to see what people think of that. I have my own opinions, but, you know. I might change them. Since ultimately these videos are meant to be watched by others. Their desires are, you know, at least somewhat relevant to what I do, although ultimately I'm just going to do what I'm going to do. Just checking Dingus count there. I've been going through and looking back at some of the stuff I've recorded already, the commentary. I apologize right now for all the popping. I guess I had the mic too close to my mouth and too much in line with my mouth, so, you know, my exhalations are directly into the mic and you get a lot of popping. It's sort of annoying, actually, but I'll be goddamned if I'm re-recording all that. It's like almost 45 minutes of me talking, so, sorry. I fix it for the last chunk when I was in the pool room, but it'll be better from there on out. I'm not going to do all that over again. I do spend effort with these videos, and I do take time to try and, like, you know, if I make a mistake, I will take time to fix it. I don't just slap it together in one shot and say, screw it, and go. But there's limits. I'm a busy man. Anyway, so I have the bow and arrow now. So, and the water's on, which I don't actually think matters, except that you have to turn it on to get the water to get the arrow to solve the puzzle. Anyways, whatever. So let's see what this thing does.
What a delightfully gruesome display.
Yeah, Laura. So that's pretty cool, I gotta say. So what the fuck is this thing? It's a music box cylinder. So actually, I was totally right.
Now I'm getting somewhere.
And that does lead to that room. And I figure at this point, like, alright, so that's the only place in the mansion I haven't been. And it's like this weird lock, alternative lock king mechanism. So. But I'm still missing two dinguses. And conveniently, there's two things I haven't figured out yet. One, I haven't gone back to the library and used the ring on that chandelier where you can pull it down. Two, I haven't figured out the grates at the bottom of the pool room. So I'm like, well, I bet those were my last two dinguses, so I decide to go to those two places first before I go to the that final room upstairs, which, again, is locked in the in Legend Manor, and see what rewards await me inside there. the text. So my next big project that I've been thinking about, again, I want to record some co-op sessions. I think it'll be fun to hear the whatever, what patter there is between me and my buddy. I also, Flylighter's Daggerfall Let's Play inspired me to do a Morrowind one. Some people expressed interest in that. It would be tough to edit because it's a long-ass game. It'd be a lot like the Deus Ex 3 Let's Play I have, but a lot longer, probably, ultimately. So I would have to edit it because there's no way that anyone would ever want to watch every single second of a full... Now this, I should have figured this out. It even says lug on the side. Yes, you can move this. Oh. Now it all makes sense. I have to use it to replace the statue. It even has like a thing sticking out like the spear would be, which is like the biggest giveaway ever. However, there's this problem where because that thing depresses a slight bit, it won't let you grab onto the thing. It makes you drop it automatically. And you can only grab on that one side where the handle is. So for a while, I think I've totally fucked myself, and I'll have to redo the entire manor because I can't complete this one fucking puzzle, and it's really frightening. But it turns out that since it's a physics object, it can be moved, however slightly, by weapons fire. So I actually just shoot the crap out of it for like 5 minutes and move it back centimeter by centimeter. I left it all in the video. I don't know if it's interesting at all, but it's kind of funny. I was like, maybe I can restart from a checkpoint, but no, I won't let you. You can restart the whole manor or keep what you've got. Probably because they didn't envision you ever getting in an unwinnable situation. Here we are. And you can see, if you stare at the wheels and look at them relative to the diagram on the board, you can see that they're moving back ever so slowly. And I just need to move it back just far enough that I can stick myself in there and grab onto the rail without being on that. It's ridiculous. But it does work. So thank God for that, I guess. I'm thinking about slash planning this Morrowind Let's Play, what kind of character I'm going to make, but it would be a big job, and I'm not sure I have time for it. It's a lot easier to record more action-type games and just slap all the footage together and render it. I won't do that much editing on the Morrowind game, obviously. You want to get some of the feeling of how expansive it is and the quiet spaces in between. But it'll be a lot like the Deus Ex Let's Play. I'm also trying to figure out how anal to be. Because you can definitely play that game making a character to do everything, pretty much. It's kind of the attraction of Elder Scrolls games. One character can do all things. And see, this is the same solution from the Legend Manor, except you had to replace the broken statue with that pile of rebar. It's pretty interesting, actually. It's fun. Ah, the dive move. I love it so much. It's like some of the most acrobatic lore gets. It's really cool. It's always fun to use. And it's a great way to kill yourself when you want to. You just, there's a dingus. 7 out of 8. Anytime you just are in a high place, you can just dive off and die if you just want to go back to the checkpoint, which occasionally is a thing that you want to do. Now back to the library and to the final dingus. Again, I found every bonus item in the manor on my own. In Legend, I was missing one, I think, and who knows where the hell it is. Although only missing one is pretty good for Legend. Where the gold ones, where I don't think I got hardly any of them in the actual levels. They are clearly in very weird places. one problem with that game is that it was so non-exploratory that it just shuttled you along these basically linear levels, and then apparently there were like these crazy side areas where you could get the you just pull it straight down and it opens that bookcase where I noticed before. So that's that. So now I've got everything, and all I have left to do is go to the music box locked room or whatever. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this Let's Play. I hope you enjoyed this commentary. I'll see you again with Underworld. Please check out the rest of my channel. It's, if you've got here some random way, not through YouTube, CWOXVIII. Or if you prefer to remember, Chauncey Winterhaven Oglethorpe the 18th, which is the genesis of that name. That's a long story. Maybe I'll tell one day. At any rate, enjoy the conservatory, the end of the level. I'll see you next mission.
What a lovely tune. When Lord Byron gave the Bridge of Sighs its name in the 19th century, he imagined what it must have been like for a prisoner to take one final look at the beauty of Venice before being led to their fate in the prison below. In the summer, the risk of flooding should not be discounted, as a single rainfall can easily last for days, overflowing the Paria River and threatening Santa Cruz de la Sierra and the Bolivian lowlands to the south. Ah!